Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship at High Country United Church of Christ. My name is Elizabeth Buchanan, and I am an old timer around here. I've been in this church since its inception, 19 years ago. After receiving the blue postcard, which some of you may have also received, I showed up at the Blowing Rock Conference Center, reluctant boys in tow, for the second ever service in August 2002. Yes, it was the second. It was not the first, because that blue postcard got stuck under a pile of stuff. And when I found it, I had missed the first. But I still consider myself a charter member of this church. And I've been hooked ever since that first Sunday. So wherever you are on your journey, or however you got here, whatever brought you here this morning, we are glad that you have come. And we hope that you will return. In this worship series, we are purposely going on a journey together. This is no ordinary journey, but a quest for deeper meaning. Questions guide us along the way. So for 4 weeks now, we have been asking hard questions, pondering how the very act of asking transforms us, challenges us to live with greater courage and love. I've been moved by hearing accounts of other members' journeys, and I would like to share some of my experience today of all this church means to me. But to do that, I need to tell you a story. Once upon a time, a long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, a woman with three boys moved a long way south to a small mountain town. All of them, all four of them, were traumatized by an ugly divorce. And they were looking for a place to heal. The woman was returning to her hometown, where her parents still lived, but the boys, ages 12, 9, and 4, had only visited a few times. They had never lived in this town. And they did not know it, but they were heading toward major culture shock. Mom, why are there so many churches? That was a question I did not expect to hear, but they'd never lived in the South. The woman, determined to be strong, though angry and hurt, and now guilty about moving the boys so far from their dad, got a job, took the boys to her old church, where they made friends, the boys started school, and they were welcomed. And as they adjusted, some of the woman's guilt began to dissipate. As she dared to hope she was getting started on a new crisis-free life, some of the walls she had built around herself began to slowly come down. And she thought they would all be okay. But then her mother was killed in a freak accident, and everything came crashing down. The woman looked for spiritual health from her old church, how to understand what had happened, and where was God. Her anger revived, her walls came up. She had nowhere to express her anger. The anger at God and questions about Christianity were not welcome or accepted in her old church. And then came the blue postcard. By now you have realized that the woman is me, and the children, Matt, David, and Michael, all adults now, in their late 20s and early 30s. I came to this church searching for meaning, empathy, a community I could trust with my whole self, not just when I'm in a good mood, or happy, or in alignment with the universe. I needed others to hear my story, to affirm and validate my strong emotions, and to make me feel like I belonged. I found all of that here, and more. One Sunday, I played the piano in worship, and before I knew it, I was playing every Sunday. For me, this church has been, forgive me, but this is a scientific metaphor, a petri dish filled with nutritious media.
Amen.
And I am a cell that has been fed, nurtured, I've grown and flourished. Truly, in every bud there is a flower. And as my protective barriers came down, I made connections. This is the culture of this church, to encourage growth and relationships, just as Jesus did with his disciples. We serve and support each other, and then we take it further, extending that love in a wider circle to those beyond our group. In my deepest soul, I know that this church is a safe place for me, where I can be vulnerable and be myself no matter how I feel. One moment sticks in my mind. I think Jennifer will remember this. When I started my first teaching job and was suffering from intense anxiety, depression, and just feeling totally overwhelmed, I sat in our sanctuary on State Farm Road. This was many years ago. And the tears just rolled down my face all through the service. And at one point, I happened to be sitting next to Tom Moore. And I just said to him, "Do you mind if I hold on to you for a while?" And of course he said yes. I'll never forget that moment. The old me, the zipped up me, would never have asked for that support. The old me probably would not have cried in church. And if I felt like I was going to cry, I wouldn't have come. But there I was, feeling that I could be how I felt in that moment. And there was the support and solace that I was looking for. So, in ways large and small, this church has helped me realize the value and grace in expanding my circles. Without the blessing of your acceptance and love, I would have stayed walled off and removed from the world, lonely, behind my protective barriers. I would have been strong. You have not only supported me through hard times, but you've also helped me to trust the goodness in others and find ways to do good in the world. Thank you for helping me to grow, to adapt, to endure, and to relax. Through all of you, God is still speaking. Sojourning God, your spirit exists everywhere, on every path, inviting us to move with curiosity and compassion toward each other. Open us to the depth of our connections, even when it seems that our differences are so profound. show us our shared humanity and teach us that it is never too late to be transformed by your love.
Amen.
Help us to know you, not just in our hearts and our minds, but in our bones. Nudge us and guide us, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God, it's me again, Margaret.
Hello, my love.
I'm falling apart. Can you put me back together?
I would rather not.
Why not?
Because you aren't a puzzle.
What about all these pieces that keep falling off of me onto the ground?
Let them stay there for a while. They fell off for a reason. Take some time and decide if you need any of those pieces back.
I don't understand. I'm breaking down.
No, you don't understand. You are breaking through. What you are feeling are just growing pains. You are shedding the things and the people in your life that are holding you back. You aren't falling apart. You are falling into place. Relax. Take some deep breaths. Allow those things you don't need anymore to fall off of you. Quit holding on to the pieces that don't fit to you anymore. Let them fall off. Let them go.
But once I start doing that, what's going to be left of me?
Only the very best pieces of you.
But I'm scared of changing.
I keep telling you. You aren't changing. You are becoming.
Becoming who?
Becoming who I created you to be. A person of light and love and charity and hope and courage and joy and mercy and grace and compassion. I made you for more than shallow pieces that you have decided to adorn yourself with. that you cling to with such greed and such fear. Let those things fall off of you. I love you. Don't change. Become. 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 Become who I made you to be. I am going to keep telling you this until you remember it.
There goes another piece.
Yep. Let it be.
So, I'm not broken?
No. You are breaking like the dawn. It's a new day. Become. Become.
Sickness, of youth and of age, of delight and joy and of lament and grief. May we understand all the pieces of who you are creating us to be. May the words of our mouths this morning, the meditations occurring here in this time and space, may they be pleasing in your sight, O God, our rock, our creator, our Redeemer and our hope. Amen and amen. So 5 weeks ago now, out there on the lawn, before we moved in underneath here, we introduced this series of quests, of asking questions, of asking those questions on the margins that oftentimes we don't want to ask. And I offered a few of mine, and then I went to the crowd and I said, so what are those questions that we're not courageous enough to ask? And praise God for Pat, who right now is in the back row. She must think she is of another denomination. Although our front rows aren't full either this day. And she started waving her hand. And so we got the microphone over to her, and she says, how do we grow old? And I thought, exactly. The question that we need to be asking is, how do we grow old? And so from that moment forward, I'm like, well, who am I going to get to visit with me about how to grow old? And what does that mean to grow old? Sure, we talk about it on Ash Wednesday when we talk about ashes to ashes and to ashes we will become. And yet we don't do that a lot of times in the church, honestly. And so one of my favorite people, the song that we just sang, Welcome, was one of Jen's favorite songs when they used to live here, and we used to see them on a more regular basis. And when they came up, I was like, yeah, we have to sing that one. And so Jen is one of my favorite conversation partners, for she has a huge passion for those among us who are over the age of 50, 52, 55, 75, 92.
And on.
And this week, in preparation for today, I just found out that Jen, down in Buncombe County, is in the beginning stages of doing the hard work of creating a $22 million, say more.
Active Aging Center.
Active Aging Center. And I don't know about you all out there, but I have heard in the last 18, 19 months, why should we spend $22 million on a population that is more susceptible to COVID than ever? Why don't we just let you all go? Right? And so, Jen, why should we spend and be excited about and do the hard work of $22 million active, not passive, active aging center?
Well, good morning and thanks for having me, and also thanks for the opportunity to talk about the Active Aging Center. So as Tamara said, my passion has been working in aging services. You can see on the handout that it talks a little bit about my background and history and my work, but really my passion is about giving back to those who have given to us and have created the environment that we see around us, and also to ensure that that's available in the future. With COVID, we know that the greatest impact was to those that were 60 and older. The virus is damaging to those individuals. And with the funding that's coming both nationwide, I think it's a great opportunity to build community for those that are 60 plus. Buncombe County is just in Buncombe. They're expecting $51 million from the American Rescue Plan funds, not to mention the $25 million that the city of Asheville is gonna be receiving. So there, it's an opportunity to really support those who have been most at risk and most suffered from this virus. The vision of the Active Aging Center, you guys have one kind of similar here, which is the Project on Aging, and some of you I may have had an opportunity to meet and work with whenever I was the director there. But we, shockingly, we actually don't have something like that in Asheville. We have some smaller community centers, but we don't have a one-stop shop, a place that you can think of where to go to find socialization opportunities and to have congregate nutrition and meals with one another and weaving classes and art classes and exercise classes and all of the things that are necessary to make sure that we age well and age healthy in our community.
So when you say active aging, so how do we actively age well and with our health?
Well, one thing is we don't stop, so we continue. When I was talking to Tamara earlier this week about it, one of the things that we know for a fact is that social isolation is one of the greatest risk factors for individuals for health-wise. It has a huge damaging effect. That's another reason how COVID has impacted us that we haven't even yet seen the ramifications of that. There's more research happening in the last 18 months around social isolation than we've ever seen before. And then there's also the physical activity. It's not just mental stimulation and social interaction, but truly physical activity. When I talk about the Active Aging Center to those in Buncombe County and those in the community, the one thing everybody always asks me though is what volunteer opportunities are there? Just because we may retire doesn't mean we stop, right? We find other ways to give back into our community. And so making sure that those opportunities are there as well, whether that be delivering Meals on Wheels through the local Meals on Wheels program, or whether that be being a greeter at the Active Aging Center or Project on Aging here, or teaching art classes or weaving classes, or becoming trained in some of the evidence-based health promotion programming that I'm gonna speak about in a few minutes and continuing to teach those. Making sure that we continue to stay both mentally and physically active. Those are really important parts, and I think one of the things that many communities have continued to try to do in building centers like senior centers or active aging centers. We also find that the name change has changed. So as you hear me talk about an active aging center, there's nothing in there really about seniors. We don't use that language typically anymore. We have changed that to be more active and more not passive, as Tamara had mentioned.
One of the links that you're gonna see about, I think is at the bottom of the piece embedded, is a link to the NC Wake Forest. It was a webinar that I was able to watch in February. And when I sent out the email, I think I tried to highlight that, and that is Dr. Jeff Williams, who is at Wake Hospital in Winston-Salem, and he is a geriatrician. And one of the things that he highlighted for me is that there is this line of act, activity and being active, and then this other line of when we die. And the goal is to keep these two lines actually as far apart as possible, which has to do with our physical selves as well as our mental processing selves, our brain cells. So how do we make sure that... I'm just going to say it. A friend of mine actually a few weeks ago was talking about his mother who came to live with him. And fairly quickly after this woman came to live with her son, she had a stroke. And what she said to her son, and she was 81 at the time, is she said to him, "I don't want to become a lump." And I don't know about you, but I don't want to become a lump either. And so how do we stay active as long as possible, right, before we actually find our life in another world?
Well, I think you can do that through things like the Active Aging Center or like the Project on Aging here, or through other volunteer opportunities. One of the things I mentioned to Tamara when we talked is that I'm really heavy into resources. So I think that you're all experts in your own life, right? But no two people are ever gonna age the same. What we need, what access to services we have available to us are different. Because the lives that we've led are different. The financial resources we have are different. The social supports that we have are different. But knowing what's available so that you can access those whenever you get to that point is really important. There are things like senior companion programs. So maybe you're not in a place in which you need a senior companion, but maybe you could be a senior companion for someone who does need that interaction, who doesn't have the ability to leave their home anymore, who doesn't have the ability to stay active and to continue to keep those two lines separated. Maybe you can volunteer, like I've mentioned, at the Meals on Wheels, or maybe that individual can still get to the Project on Aging and they can do things like exercise classes. There's in the handout that you have, there's a talk about evidence-based health promotion programming. And what I want to put in a plug about that is that those are really good ways to continue to remain active as we age. And so there's things like falls prevention programs. Falls prevention is a huge risk factor to people of all ages. Anybody can fall at any point. But how do we get back up from a fall if we have one is incredibly important. Things like a matter of balance, those classes teach you that. Tai Chi is an excellent way to continue to keep those lines further apart. And also walk with ease. The reason I mention these programs is there's opportunity to get trained in. You could start teaching them here at the church, actually. When I looked at the link that I've listed there for you, you can see where they're being offered across the state. There are a couple hours training, and then there's 6 weeks specific scheduled trainings or specific scheduled classes. And one of the programs that I saw was actually being run at a church in Winston-Salem. It's a way to continue to remain active and either do it through falls prevention work or also evidence-based health promotion or chronic disease self-management, which is for things like if someone's dealing with diabetes or another chronic disease and helping you come up with ways to manage those symptoms and interact with others who are experiencing similar things in their lives.
So why do we not like to talk about it? Why do we not want to talk about our wisdom years?
I think it's fear. That's what I believe a lot of it is. I think when I used to be the director for Council on Aging, we kind of had this joke that nobody knew about us until they needed us. And I find that that's really what we hear, and that's really sad. I think that a lot of people are fearful that if they talk about it, it's going to come more quickly. I would say that if we're fortunate enough, we'll all be here and we all need to experience it at some point. And so I really think, and we don't know what our future is going to hold, right? So we don't know if we're going to end up which chronic disease we're going to have. And if we start talking about it or interacting with those who are experiencing that, there's fear in that too. There's fear in the unknown. And if we don't think about it, we don't have to really face reality. We can keep pushing it further and further. But ultimately, when we get there, what I find in my world is that people are in crisis by the time they actually do reach out to me. And they don't have a good plan. And we talk a lot about actually starting to create some training classes on pre-planning. Pre-planning what it is that you want your years to look like. whether you do that now or 5 years from now, you have an opportunity to really think through, like, what are the things that you want to make sure you do? What are some of the ways that you want to continue to be involved in your community? What are some of the decisions you want made before you get into a crisis situation and have to make them? On your handout, there's a thing I've listed here called the Game of Life, and I actually stole that from a friend of mine in the middle of the state who ran a program called the Game of Life, and they gave out passports, and they did trainings similar to this, but they did them for, I think, 4 weeks, and they had everybody come in, and they talked about future decisions that people may have to make, such as rehab. You know, by the time if you break a leg or something in your hip and you end up at the hospital, you have to decide which rehab facilities you want to go to while you're in the hospital. You may never have stepped foot in a rehab facility and have no idea which one you would want to go to. So making sure that you have done that, making sure you've gone through that planning process so that when that moment of crisis is there, you have those decisions made and you're not having to decide that on top of the crisis situation you're dealing with in the moment. And there's just some other examples of places that you might want to go check out in the planning of the future.
I think 3 years ago, and he's not here today, Craig Weaver led a book study on Richard Rohr's Falling Upward. And in this book, it really talks about the spirituality of our two lives. Our early life of becoming and our older life of becoming wise. And in that book, a huge piece of the spirituality of us aging is to not be afraid. And when we read our biblical text from the very beginning until the end, the theme that is throughout it is to not be afraid. And even in Ephesians, it says, have no fear, but with joy and celebration, let all your supplications be made known to God. That's Tamara's rendition of it. And as I say that, one of the things that was made known to me is we have a set of friends who, when they turn 60, they, as a set of friends, actually hold a ritual, a celebration for those in their circles as they turn 60, celebrating their wisdom. Celebrating that now they get to do things like wear purple and red hats, if you know that poem. Mm-hmm. They get to maybe be a little bit more crass than maybe who they were as their 27 or 32-year-old person because they've earned it. And so I just want to also put that out there. And I know as I look out amongst our crowd here, the majority of us here are over 60. And so what rituals, and I don't know if this is a piece of your programming, can we be doing for our spiritual health, our emotional health, that actually celebrates our wise years, our coming of wisdom?
So it makes me think about, I don't know if there's something like this here, but in Buncombe County, there is a group called Blue Ridge Pride, and we just recently funded them, and they're doing an LGBTQ stories, because I think those are the things that are really important. When I was here at Project on Aging, we were starting to do that. We were making sure that we were getting the stories from those who are 60 plus and celebrating them. I know I personally have learned a ton in my career, my 15 years of doing this work, from individuals who have been at the Senior Center, who have shared their stories with me, who I have been blessed to get to spend time with them. And I think if there are opportunities like that here, or if there's not, that's a good thing for maybe the church to create, but an opportunity for people to share their stories and to make sure that those voices live on into the future. I love the idea of the celebration when we're 60 or 65, or really any opportunity to celebrate our lives, I think are important. And I do think it's about fear, and I think it's about our own mortality, and that we don't want to see it. I don't know how many times I've heard people say, I'm not going to go to the Senior Center because I'm not that old. I'm not that person. I don't want to see that particular, you know, because there's fear there. I'm afraid I'm going to look like that or be like that at some point in the future. You know, so how can we move from that to feel like it's really an opportunity to be active and to be socially stimulated? And if there's not something at your local senior center, reach out and maybe see if you could create what it is that you want to see there. Maybe help create the environment that you would like to have so that others like you might be wanting and willing to go as well.
So as I sit here, I'm realizing that you have two 50-year-old women talking to you. And I think it's time for the microphone to go out there. And so what comments, what questions, what statements would you like all of us to hear? And I'm going to see how far this microphone goes. And I'm not sure that we set it up really well for that today. I apologize. And or you can come to me because you're not a lump yet.
Do you mind if I share another little thing before, as you're, and I really wish people would come and share your thoughts or comments or questions. I'm really good at questions. But one of the things that I feel like is really important for me to make sure that I say is the number one call and request that I get from people is asking about in-home care. And I really want to make sure that I take a moment to speak to that, if that's okay. I know it's a little bit off of script, but I think it's important because it's the number one call I have always received. And really, it's about making sure that people understand and know your health insurance benefits, understand and know what Medicare pays for and what it doesn't pay for, understanding how Medicaid works, and whether or not long-term care insurance may be an option for you or something you would want to look into. And I say that because whether you are needing placement or whether you're just needing somebody to come in and do like cleaning in your homes, there's a lot of times that people have questions around that and just want to make sure that people have an opportunity to think again about that before that time comes, before you need that.
Anybody?
Thank you for sharing. Thank you for both of those stories. But I also would say that that is a very frequent comment I would hear at the Project on Aging. And again, I think that's one of the important parts of finding others to be around, to console with, to talk about, to see maybe they have some suggestions on, maybe they use some new can opener on which to be able to open the bottle, or there's opportunity for sharing experiences when we continue to build those socialization and those opportunities for outreach. Again, evidence-based health promotion programming and classes that are offered for exercise are also good ways to continue to manage and deal with any of the physical ramifications that come up as we age as well. On point. And that's another reason that I give presentations like this, not to just groups like this, but to people in their 40s and 50s so that they understand and respect their parents and what they can still do. And that we don't, their goal should never be to stop preventing you from doing the things that you can currently do. We want people to continue to do that. We want you to continue to get up and dance and do all of the wonderful things that you've been doing. And it's, again, that education piece. I think they have fear. They're worried about you. They're now worried something's going to happen and they didn't step in to do something. They have a lot of fear around that. So they have a lot of opportunity for education. I would encourage you to have them reach out. I don't know where they live, but if they live somewhere in which they could call an aging service provider. We provide a lot of education to caregivers. I say that with like quotations, because people at a distance, even if they may think that they're a caregiver because they have worry and fear, and they can find out, like, what can you do? What should you not do? Where are your limits? Where are your boundaries? Because we don't ever want anybody to feel like we're taking from them before they are ready to give any of that up.
When I saw what Sandra was going to do today, and she's going to sing that "We're Not Broken," I thought, what perfect introduction to this conversation. So I'm going to invite us into a time of silence. You've just heard some small seeds planted, scattered about. You have a handout embedded within the worship guide. I'm just going to invite you now into a time of silence. to just hear what the Spirit is offering to you. I also want to lift up as I hear our children scream and play on the playground that school is starting. And in this season, there is both delight and energy and excitement and a bit of dread and trepidation. And so may we hold our administrators and teachers, as well as the parents and those students, as our schools are re-engaging and reopening a new year. I'm going to invite us right now to indeed connect our spirits with one another And may we hold the unitive consciousness that literally we are all one. For those of us who are Q-tips, for those of us who are bald, whether in infancy or old age, we are one. And when we understand our spirits, that when one person is aching or fearful, that impacts all of us. When we understand joy and celebration, that impacts all of us. And so, Great Spirit, enrich our souls with years of wisdom, grow our hair thick and white. May we know the rich depth of all of our life seasons, from the new life of spring, the growth of summer, the harvest of autumn, and the rest of winter. And especially during this current season, this time, when many are asked to shelter in place, we acknowledge that some of us experience this sheltering as isolation and fear for our own well-being, for our own healthy lives. And truly, we do know a truth that some of us struggle to access health care and support. We need to be well. Some of us don't want to ask about those situations until we are in crisis. And others of us are criminalized by our own poverty. We understand that our worth and our dignity cannot be erased or altered by any human judgment. We also understand that none of us will be free until all of us are free. We are lovingly bound one to another. May we understand that a caring community and connections and expressions of your perfect love truly do bring about a kingdom of hope and grace and mercy. We ask, Holy Creator, to help each of us, your beloved, to know that we are connected to the Great Spirit, to the Holy One, and to understand where healing will seep into our very essence. May we know that we are never alone, that we are truly seen for who we are in our fullness, that we are heard, and that we are loved. Hold us, love us, offer us freedom. Amen and amen. As our musicians play a hymn of promise, in the bud there is a flower. There are words there. They're going to play two verses of this, I think. And I offer those words there as meditation. And I'm going to invite Dave to his right. There are baskets. And if you will get those baskets going among us, Dave, that would be fantastic. As we collect our offering, may we respond in ways beyond financial gifts, but with our hearts and our spirits and our souls. May we understand all that we have to offer.
Thank you.
the gifts offered, from amazing musicians to players with Kaylee that they are having the greatest time on the playground, to paint and to plantings around our space, to lawn mowers and to phone callers and to food deliverers and to presence, right? For your very presence here this morning and listening to our stories and being available, may all these gifts, may they be multiplied in ways beyond our own imagination. I invite you to stand up and to go find an other, a second or a third, to keep your distance and to offer this benediction one to another. I'm going to invite you to go find somebody, look in their eyes, and to communicate with your eyes to one another. And let us say these words. Repeat after me as you offer this benediction to your neighbor. As we travel to various places this week, may we be aware, our very movement is a spiritual act. Expanding our horizons, traveling beyond our preconceptions, embracing the infinite delight of this earth and its creatures, human and beyond.
May the Creator
continue your unfolding point to them. May Christ accompany, point to them your deeper knowing. And may the Spirit enliven your growing. And may we all continue. On the journey creating the kingdom of love. As our musicians play, make sure you know the name of the person that you just blessed. May we go in peace.